growing in grace. Because if someone in grace, and we're talking about growing in the grace of God. I'll be taking our key scripture from 2 Peter, chapter 3, 17 and 18. Now, 2 Peter is in the New Testament. Peter was one of the disciples of Jesus Christ, and he was the apostle of the church when Jesus left. So another one, he took over the leadership. Jesus handed it over to him. Now this is what he's saying to us. This is one of his writings, one of the things he said right when he was alive to the people of God. Chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. He says here, "You therefore, beloved," now he's talking to Christians, now he's not talking to unbelievers. He said, "You therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware, lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and forever. Amen."
Amen.
Praise God. Now, for brevity's sake, I'm just going to run through what it is, because we don't have as much time to deal with this. Now, the Bible talks about the grace of God in the New Testament. But let me give you this illustration. If grace means an unmerited favor, it means you didn't deserve to have it. When God created man, he gave man the whole world. Man was the child of the earth. He made him a God. He said, "Dominion shall do the earth, run over everything, make sure it's working well." The only assignment God gave to man was just to maintain the garden. Man wasn't meant to be working, laboring, and doing all that, just to maintain the garden. But as a result of sin, man fell from glory to grass. He fell from grace, and then he fell into grass. He started struggling, and then God cursed the land. He cursed everything, and everything started working against man. Now, and then, because man has fallen from the realm of the spirit, because the spirit controls the physical, man is first of all a spirit. He has a soul, he has a body. You are not your body. Your body is just a container. When this body dies, you still live on. Because you have a spirit, and the spirit came from God, and you have a soul, and the soul will face judgment. So you need to understand that basically, everything that came from this earth will go back to the earth, because this flesh came from the earth, will go back to the earth. Your spirit came from God, it will go back to God. Your soul is you, and it will be judged how you live your life. That's why the Bible says, "The soul that sinneth, he shall die." Now it's talking about the second death. So it's important to understand this basic thing, that man fell from grace and he fell into sin. He became reduced in potential. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God." So the glory of God was what made man to take dominion, was what made man to be man. But he fell from it and went down. As a result, man couldn't do certain things which God has destined him to do. The Lord came and the Lord couldn't set us free. Because on your own effort, there's no how you can live a holy life. The spirit that would make you live a holy life is dead. That's what was happening in the Old Testament. The flesh was in charge. So they were trying as much as possible to live a holy life. God gave them law. They couldn't walk up to the law. They couldn't meet up with the law. Every attempt was, the more the law gave was as if the law magnified sin. The blood of rams and goats could not remove the sinful nature in man. And as long as the sinful nature, the damned nature was in man, man was programmed for sin, kept on sinning. But thanks be to Jesus Christ, who came to us. When Jesus was given to us, the Bible says he was full of grace and truth. So grace was ushered in, whereby it is no more of our own strength, it is now his own ability to help us become what God has destined us to become. So bear this in mind, that without the grace of God, every single person on the face of this earth will suffer. Without the grace of God, the curses which God has reenacted at the Garden of Eden is still in force. I was telling someone, I said, no matter how much a man is so powerful, so close to God, one day he's going to die. Because God has said the days of man shall not exceed 120 days, 120 years. So there's no how. There is a curse which God invoked at the Garden of Eden, which is there. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, but you need to understand that there are certain things within the time you have to live on the surface of earth, you can enjoy every single moment of it. And that is where the grace of God comes in place. So you need the grace of God. And Paul Peter is saying something here, that if we don't grow in the grace of God, once you become a Christian, a believer, you will become so frustrated that you will walk away from Christianity. He's saying here that if you don't grow, because in the Bible you could see a lot of people that were working with Paul the Apostle. People like Demas, people like Hymenaeus, all those people. For you to walk with someone like Paul the Apostle, you must have reached a level with God. They were going from one place to the other, doing missionary work, and all of a sudden these people just turned their back against God, and they were no longer Christians, and they were fighting with what they once believed. So if you are not careful, if you are not growing in grace, you could come to a point where the things of God will no longer make sense to you. Where it will just look like you are wasting time because you will say it is not working. And the reason why you say that is not because God is not God, it's not because God is not powerful, it's because you are not growing in grace. Because it is the grace of God that makes a difference. Paul said, I am what I am today by the grace of God. It is the grace of God that can change your life. It is the grace of God that can make all the curses that God has put in place not to work against you. Okay. So you need to understand, so Jesus came, he ushered in this grace upon us. That is why the Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8, for by grace are ye saved through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Your salvation did not occur by your own strength. You didn't wake up one morning and say, yes, I'm going to serve God today. No, something happened. The first thing that happened was your spirit got regenerated. If your spirit is not regenerated, you won't be here this morning. The first thing the Holy Spirit will do is to convict your spirit. That is why when your spirit has been regenerated, you will begin to look for God. A man with an unregenerated spirit will not look for God. That's why the Bible says in Corinthians that a natural man cannot receive the things of God. Because he's so natural. His spirit is dead. He's not looking for God. He's only looking for earthly things, earthly pleasure. Because he's of this earth. He's only operating in the realm of the soul and the flesh. So he only wants to satisfy himself, enjoy himself, and that is what the things life is all about. No! There is a life after this place. There is a God that created man. And that God placed that spirit in you. But once your spirit gets regenerated, then you begin to look for God. That is when you will now hear somebody preaching somewhere, you got saved. It's not because the person preaches, it's because your spirit was already regenerated. Your spirit was already looking for God. Your spirit wanted a change. You were already ripe for harvest. And the word just came, and then you give your heart to Jesus. And then you got saved. And then you have a conscience that you want to please God. You want to do things that will bring glory to His name. And that is where you now need to understand. Because the concept of grace is a very, very vital concept. It's a very important thing. The devil has now introduced error. And that's what Peter was saying. That the enemy has introduced error into the teaching of grace. And people don't understand it. And because the error has come into the teaching of grace, there are so many Christians that are living in error. You know what heresy is? Heresy is 99% truth, 1% error. So you would think everything is sound, but they've introduced one error, and that error is capable of destroying your life and sending you to hellfire. So that is why we need to understand what grace is. It's an unmerited favor, but how do we grow in it? How do we understand it? If grace is a part of God's nature, because God, we didn't deserve it. The Bible says in Romans 5:8 that God commended his love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We did not deserve it. We didn't deserve it, but because of his nature, God is loving in nature, he's gracious. The Bible says he's rich in mercy. Because of his nature, he showed his love towards you. He showed his love towards you, and thereby usher in grace, because they looked at it and how can these people get saved? Of their own doing, they can't be saved. They can never escape the corruption that is in the world through lust and sin. They can't. As long as they have this Adamic nature, they will keep sinning. But there is something that God can do that will take them out of that realm, whereby they will get to a point where they can control themselves. They have control over what is happening in their life. I sign this to let you know this, that the blood of Jesus destroyed the power of sin. The blood of Jesus destroyed the power of sin. Every child of God that has accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior, the blood of Jesus, what the blood did was to destroy the nature of sin. Because as long as you are still living in sin, there is no how the grace can actually work for you. You need to understand that. So the blood of Jesus ushers in forgiveness and it ushers in grace. Because without mercy, there can't be grace. God will first of all show you mercy, then he will bring in his grace. Hallelujah. Can I hear somebody shouting? Amen.
Amen.
So you need to understand that salvation is indeed the most extraordinary expression of God's grace. Salvation is the greatest miracle that can ever happen to anyone. That your name is written in the book of life is the greatest miracle that can ever happen to you. When the disciples went out, they came back to Jesus and said, demons bow to us. We did so many people. We did so many miracles. They were giving testimonies of what happened, how they got blessed because they didn't carry cross, how people gave them gifts and all that. Jesus, all those things are not important. The most important thing is that your names are written in the book of life, which is the most important thing. Because if your name is not written in the book of life, no matter what you do on earth, you will go to hell. So you need to understand these things, that grace has been released into us. Grace has been given to us. Now let's look at it. What does it mean when a man is living under the grace of God? When you're living under the grace of God, there's something that happens to you. You are motivated to serve Christ. You are motivated to serve God when the grace of God is released to you. You wake up in the morning, you will feel like praying. You wake up in the morning, it's not burdensome for you to read the Bible. It's not burdensome for you to reach out to people. It's not burdensome for you to come to church. It's not burdensome. You're just appreciating. You just love him. You just want to be in his presence. Now that is the grace of God at work in your life. But the Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 8, it says, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. If you want to do good work, it's the grace of God that can make it happen. Don't you ever think that Paul the apostle became a great apostle by his own strength? No. It was the grace of God. That is why he said in 1 Corinthians 15:10, that I am what I am today by the grace of God. You are what you are today by the grace of God. If God was to leave you over to the enemies, maybe you might have been dead by now. There were so many people that were born on the same day you were born and that are dead. There are so many people that were born the same day that are not where you are today. But the grace of God has made the difference in your life. So I am what I am today by the grace of God. So no man can come and say, well, it's by my own effort. It's by what you are saying. It's because I did it. No. You did not qualify for it. It is God's gracious nature to just help you, to just give it to you. Don't deserve it. You don't deserve it. The greatest man, the richest man, and all these people, it's just his grace. It's not because they deserve it. There's no man that deserves it. It's just the grace. Because man fell from grace to grass. So you need to understand this, so to live under the grace of God motivates you to serve him. So when you say, I have the grace of God, I'm under the grace of God, I'm operating under the grace of God, what does that mean? It means that there is a motivation in you to do extraordinary things for God. It's that the grace, God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency, that means you will not lack anything. There won't be a reason why you can't serve God. There won't be a reason why you say, I'm not going to serve myself. Having this, it will make all the grace you need to succeed abound you, so that you may abound in every good work. God wants you to do good work. He doesn't want to start giving excuses. God, it's because of this, because of that. Every excuse, if you look at it yourself, the excuses you are making are not excuses. Some of them are just laziness. Some of them are just because you can't be bothered. Indifference. They are not excuses. So you need to understand that as you allow the grace of God, as the grace of God is being formed in you, and as you're growing in the grace of God, you will have that strong quest in your heart to serve Him, to work for Him. Praise God. Amen. Number two, the grace of God brings speed. Everything you want to achieve, you see speed. You know, the speed of God comes into it. You see speed in your marriage, speed in your finances, speed in your business, speed in your home, where other people are failing and falling. You see that God is just doing it for you. You'll just be amazed. You know, when the grace of God is above yourself, you'll be surprised. You say, wow, this little effort, the great effort, great harvest. What have I just done? Great harvest. You will know that this is the grace of God, not you, because you didn't do anything. God was just blessing it. In the book of 1 Kings 19, verse 14, after Elijah finished praying, and he told King Ahab, go and go down, for it is going to rain. The Bible says in verse 8, 46, that the power of the Lord came to Elijah, and talking his cloak into his bed, he ran ahead of Ahab and the way to Jezreel. When the anointing of God comes upon you, when the grace of God comes upon you, the divine favor of God comes upon you, you will just realize that you will just overtake every single person that have gone ahead of you. When the grace of God comes upon your business, you'll be dazed. No matter what you want to sell, no matter what you're doing, if you just look at you're the only person in town, it's the grace of God that makes a difference. If the grace of God comes upon your studies, you'll be surprised how you will go so far. If the grace of God comes upon your marriage, you will just realize that you will not suffer any stress. If the grace of God comes upon anything you are doing, you just realize that the thing will begin to work out. But why is it that many Christians are struggling? Why is it that many Christians are not achieving things in their life? It's because they are not growing in the grace of God. And that's what Peter was saying here. That be careful so that you will not step out of God. Because you will say that God is not answering my prayers. God is not doing it. It's not that you are the one that is not growing in grace. Praise the Lord. So it brings divine speed. The grace of God sustains us in our trials. Every child of God will go through trial in life. Don't ever think you won't. Jesus went through trials. You will go through trials. It's part of the Christian life. You go through challenges. You go through a time when your endurance will be tested. What your faith will be tested. What you believe will be tested. If you are a true Christian, it will be tested. That is when you know if truly you are a child of God. When you are going through a testing period and you give up, then you don't know what you believe. But during that time, when you're going through those trials, the grace of God sustains you. It keeps you going on. That even though things are not working out, you don't have money to pay the bills, you are working so hard, things are not working, or maybe you are experiencing one form of delay or the other, you are still not bothered because you know that in due season, God will bless you. That is the grace of God sustaining you. You know that in due season, One unusual thing about Abraham in the Bible was that Abraham was operating on that grace. At that time, there was no law, you know that. There was no law in the days of Abraham. He was operating on that grace. He understood what grace was all about. That's why the Bible says he hoped against hope. When you understand what grace is all about, you know that grace can never fail. When the grace of God is upon you, it will never fail. Never. It will never fail. The trial will be for a while, but it will not quench you. It will not destroy you. It's just for a while. So don't give up when you're going to trials in life. Don't get discouraged. Don't say negative things. Don't try to quench the grace or frustrate the grace of God by your attitude. A lot of people worsen their situation when things are not going on well, and then they get depressed, they get discouraged, they begin to sell kind of things, they begin to say this. You are getting into a state of apostasy if care is not taken. If God is not thinking you will work out of what you believe, doesn't mean that what you believe is not true. You just need to have that understanding that trials are part of it. They are part of the Christian race. Praise God. You can't escape it. They are part of it. Praise God. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 2:3, it says, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. You must endure hardship. God knows that at times Christians will go through hardship. When you're going through hardship, it doesn't mean He has forsaken you. It doesn't mean He has abandoned you. It doesn't mean He doesn't love you. All He wants to do is He wants to process you, prepare you for where He's taking you to. So you need to have that understanding. Praise God. Now the next point I want to talk about is to live under grace always leads to a desire to please God in thoughts and in deeds. We're going to look at what Peter was saying there, and we'll look at the two extremes about the issue of grace. Titus chapter 2 verses 11 to 12 says, "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age." So the grace of God instructs us to live a righteous life. The grace of God instructs us to live a sensible life. The grace of God instructs us to live a godly life. So don't ever think because you're under the grace of God, you can do anything you want to do. No. He doesn't allow that. Then the grace instructs us to live a right life. Praise God. Praise God. So it's important for you to have this understanding of the grace of God. Because if you don't have this understanding, you will begin to walk in error. Because there are so many teachers now teaching error. They're teaching error. You need to understand the scripture well. You need to understand it. The Bible says, "He that is born of God does not commit sin." So if he that is born of God is committing sin, is he still born of God? There's something wrong with him. So you need to have that understanding. You need to have this understanding. And that's what we're going to look at. We're going to look at two important extremisms that is affecting the teaching of grace. One is legalism. What does it mean to be legalistic? Legalism is the attempt to be holy by keeping certain standards, usually man-made standards, without dealing with your heart. For example, in the days of Jesus Christ, you have the Pharisees who were more concerned about ceremonial purities. They're talking about you washing your hands before you eat, washing your hands, doing all that. They were more concerned about things like that, much more than the quality of their hearts. They were serving God with their lips, not from their hearts. Everything they were doing was hypocritical. Praise God. So they were hypocrites. They didn't understand what it is. They were legalistic people. They didn't understand what it means to walk in the grace of Christ. Was trying to teach them that you see all these things, you see all these things, but you're not even doing it. Your heart is far from God. Just like in Amaziah, in the book of 2 Chronicles 25 verse 2, who did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, but not with his own heart. So a legalistic person will tell you, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. Too many do's and don'ts. But it doesn't have anything to do with the heart.
By the flesh,
judge by the physical things that you do, not by the spiritual things, not by the quality of your heart. Those are legalistic persons. And that is what is affecting a lot of things and affecting the teaching of grace, where some people think they can actually get to heaven by their own efforts. No, you cannot. It's not by your own effort that you can make it to heaven. It is by the grace of God. It is by the grace of God that you can make it to heaven. It is by the grace of God. We had teachers when we were growing up in those days, you know, back in Africa. There was a lot of controversies which our fathers in the Lord were bringing up there. A lot of things. There was women must cover their hair. If you don't cover your hair, you are dishonoring the angels, you are dishonoring God, and you will go to hell. And then the same people will come to Europe. They'll go to America, they will preach a congregation of people with that are not covering their hair. And so you need to understand those are legalistic things. It's got nothing to do with the heart. The way we were brought up in those days, my relationship with my wife could have ended. Because in those days, the way I was brought up, if you wear a trouser, as far as I'm concerned, you are a sinner, you are an unbeliever, you can't go to heaven. We had a serious argument on that. I said, if I'm going to marry you, you can't wear a trouser. It's not allowed. She was like, why should you show me in the Bible where it is? I went to Deuteronomy, where the Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy, that a woman must not wear that which belongs to a man. I said, well, you said that's not what the Bible is saying. I said, that is what the Bible is saying because that's what I've been taught. And then she said something to me. She said, before you make whatever decision you want to make, why don't you go and pray? Let God speak to you. You don't just make it and say you're going to cancel a relationship because I'm wearing trousers. And then I said, okay, no problem, I'm going to pray. When I went to pray, God said, leave my daughter alone. I said, God, how can you say that? She's doing what is wrong. He said, leave her alone. Over the years, as we began to grow, we realized that those things were social cultural influence on Christianity, on the religion. Those are legalistic things that have no eternal values.